Namaskar and a warm welcome on behalf of the PIC for the release of the policy roadmap for making Pune metropolitan region carbon free by 2030. The threat to our environment and climate is very real, and the need for action is equally crucial. The energy, environment, and climate change vertical at the PIC focuses on research policy and outreach on climate change mitigation and climate smart development. The PIC policy paper completed under the visionary leadership of Professor Amitav Malik on making Pune metropolitan region carbon neutral by 2030 has evolved after a careful study of the baseline carbon emission of the PMR region, followed by several rounds of discussions with environmental experts and NGOs around Pune, who have together formed a special knowledge partnership group called Climate Collective Pune under the PIC umbrella. The report lays out a well-conceived step-by-step action plan to decarbonizing the Pune region while also stabilizing the environment for sustaining the pace of ambitious sustainable development. The roundtable will highlight the recommendations of the policy roadmap for specific actions. The Chief Minister of Maharashtra, Shri Uddhav Ji Barasaheb Thakre, could not be here, but he sent us a letter of encouragement, and I'd like to read that out. I'm very happy to know that the Pune International Centre has brought focus on global warming and climate change for defining suitable actions by Pune and Maharashtra. Already, we are seeing an increasing impact of climate change on normal life, like extreme weather events, floods, hailstorms, and droughts across Maharashtra, and more frequent cyclones around our national coastlines. It is time to act on time to avoid disasters. We know that Mumbai is vulnerable to rising sea levels, and it is time to realize the urgency of climate action and reduce our carbon dioxide emissions to mitigate climate change. In fact, it should be looked as a climate emergency. This is indeed a race against time for our state and our nation to protect the environment for our future generations and to ensure sustainable economic development. Although the problem is global, the solutions must emerge from local actions. I therefore compliment Pune International Centre for taking the lead in making Pune region carbon neutral by 2030, and I hope that this will serve as a model to be followed by other cities, not only in Maharashtra, but also in the country. I assure you that the state government will be very proactive in taking bold interventions to make Maharashtra one of the leading climate resilient states. My best compliments for such future endeavors. Yours truly, Uddhav Barasaheb Thakre. That was a message from the Chief Minister. Dr. Raghunath Mashelkar, scientist, president of the Pune International Center and innovation man, may I request you to give your opening statements.
Our beloved Honorable Minister of Environment, Aditya Thakre, our most revered Vice President, Dr. Vijay Kelkar, Professor Amitav Malik, the Sutradhar, if I can use that word. Because of him, we are all here, his energy, his passion. Ladies and gentlemen, let me first of all very warmly welcome our Honorable Minister and also say how much we appreciate your deep commitment. I remember the phone call that we had and you committed. I did not realize that Wednesdays are cabinet meetings, and he did the cabinet meeting and flew here specially to attend this. I think he deserves a round of applause for your commitment. So thank you. Thank you very much, truly grateful. I'm going to keep my remarks very brief, and the only thing I will not talk about is climate change, because the rest of it you will we talk about. PIC, as you know, is a leading think tank. It is always ahead of the curve, and it creates policy papers which are aspirational, not only for India, for Maharashtra, for all of us. And I would say the report that we have created today, thanks to Dr. Amitav Malik and his wonderful team, all the eminent advisors that we had, which our Honorable Minister will release very shortly, is very aspirational. Because when we say carbon neutral Pune by 2030, you see even California is saying 2040, other countries are saying 2050, but we are saying 2030. It's good to set up a high benchmark. I always tell my young friends that aspirations are your possibilities. Keep them high. If you aim at Everest, at least you will land at Kanchenjunga. But if you aim at Kanchenjunga, you might not even land at Hanuman Tekri. So I think we are keeping our aspirations high, and Pune has always done it. Most important part is converting ideas into action. There are lots of ideas, and that action means every citizen's action matters. And of course, the government policy is going to play a very critical role, and that's why the presence of Honorable Minister is very special. I must acknowledge the proactive and very innovative initiative our Honorable Minister has taken. As some of you might have seen, he gave a pledge. To whom? To the young students. Because it is their future, that's what we are talking about. And creating awareness, creating their commitment is very important. And we have seen the magic of the young, the power of the young. I mean, look at this young girl, Greta Thunberg. Just at the age of 15, she sat outside the Swedish parliament. And her actions were so powerful that she was considered as the 100 most influential people in the year, and even nominated for Peace Nobel Prize. You know, somebody as young as 15. And therefore, you're inspiring those young people. Who knows? We will have hundreds of Greta's coming out here. So the significance of what you've done, I think I want to really emphasize. The last point is a little bit on a sort of personal side. You know what had happened? The Honorable Chief Minister was kind enough to ask me to meet him on 1st January, which happens to be my birthday. So I could not have celebrated my birthday better than meeting him. And I remember Adityaji walking in at that time. And we had a conversation of almost 45, 50 minutes on a variety of issues, including climate change, by the way. And I remember this issue of single-use plastics came up. And I remember your very enlightened and insightful comments on single-use plastic. Little did I know at that time that he will become the environment minister, by the way. So all that I would say while at the end, and I'm cutting out my 10 minutes to 5 minutes, that we have just the right minister, full of youth, energy, enthusiasm, and we could not have had a better individual to release our PIC's report. So may I request you to release our report first in Marathi and then in English.
Thank you, sir. Professor Amitav Malik has been a defense scientist and an environmental crusader, and it is under his leadership that this policy paper has been realized. May I request Professor Malik to talk about the roadmap?
Namaskar and welcome. very happy that we have a young environment minister of the state, Shri Aditya Thackeray. We could not have asked for a better person, because this is the young, the youth that is going to change the future. So very warm welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Mashilkar, Dr. Kelkar, friends, a warm welcome from me and my team and my colleagues who have worked together to bring this document into reality. So I must put on record that many members of the Climate Collective Pune have actually not only given thought process to this, but they have actually even got involved with making it. I have some wonderful young team members in the PIC. They have worked for many months, almost a year. And this is the result that we are discussing today. So all credit goes to them. May I suggest a big hand. Just to reflect back, PIC started in 2011. And we, in 2012, we thought of bringing environment, energy, and national security together. And since I had worked with Dr. Kalam for many years, he had to come for that function. And I still remember his word. He gave a word of saying that if you want to make a change in all over, start with your own city. So today, in a way, is a tribute to Dr. Kalam and his advice. With that, coming now to the subject, what you see on the screen is the beautiful scenery that actually Earth is. And for ages, we have always had carbon neutrality. The balance was natural. It is we, the human being, that we have disturbed it, and therefore the onus is on us to correct it. How did we reach here? So obviously, it's worthwhile taking a look back and look forward. So if we look back, we will see that our population in 50 years ago, that is 1970, was about 4 billion. Today we are 7.7 billion. And if you are looking at, next, if you are looking at 2070, another 50 years ahead, we would have crossed 10 billion. Likewise, you see the energy consumption has gone 4 times. The carbon emission has gone 5 times. Unfortunately, next, the carbon emission, CO2 and the like gases, they are invisible, odorless. They cannot be detected. They keep on adding. And therefore, we are at a place where it will start affecting our normal life. And that we have all known, we now call it the climate change. But the climate change has happened because of the excess heating of the Earth and the atmosphere. As long as the Earth and the atmosphere could absorb that heating, we were still at average one plus minus 1 degree of the standard. Now we have gone beyond that, and therefore we have a problem. Next. So looking forward, if we say another 50 years, next, we are not only looking at population increase, but we are also looking at warming definitely more than 2 degrees, more likely approaching 3 degrees. And that would mean extreme weather events, droughts, floods, wildfires. That will be the new norm rather than exception. And if it gets bad, then we of course have the sea rise, refugees, stress across the society, and that could lead to the next world war. And that is the kind of scenario that we are looking at. The concern is that while all the nations have come together and pledged some kind of commitment, but even if all the commitments are really honored, which we doubt, but even if that happens, that will not be sufficient. So we are looking at a situation where we are still going on adding 50 gigatons of CO2 equivalent gases per year. And if we really want to control things, then we have to come down to 30 gigaton. The difference between ice age and the hothouse Earth is only about 5 to 6 degrees. So as we approach that kind of situation, we are actually risking losing control over our environment. Avoiding climate catastrophe also will have an effect on economy, and that's the new element. And what we understand today that the sequestration by nature, by trees and all, it's very good, it will work, but only to an extent. We have gone beyond that, and therefore we will have to take the help of our technology. So this century will be a kind of a do or die decision century for the future of humanity. Let's understand why we are talking about Pune and the city. Because the cities occupy only 2% of the land, but they are responsible for more than 70% of the energy consumption as well as the emission. Cities also are very centers of wealth generation, activity. If things have to happen, then obviously it must begin by city. The other part is we say climate change is a global problem, but there is no global solution as such. The solutions must emerge from the local. And it's for that reason that we are looking at what can be done. The message that I would like to express instead of going through the whole thing, can you go further? Next. Yeah, that net carbon neutrality alone can stabilize the environment, and the stable environment is a necessity for economic progress, for the human, for humankind to make progress. So we get into the nitty-gritties, and some of it will be covered in more detail by my friends here, who are here. But in short, the three numbers there indicate the total emission, the current scenario, below that is business as usual, and below that is the if we follow the roadmap. We see that the current scenario is itself bad. If we continue with the business as usual, the emissions will be so large that there will be no way of compensating them. However, if we do take proactive action for controlling the emission or reducing the emission, then it might come into the range of about 5 megaton. There is 5,712 kiloton. And that kind of a figure is probably it is possible to compensate with technology. So making Pune carbon neutral actually has to be focused on reducing per capita emission because our population is going on increasing, our activity is going on increasing. So we have to find a way of doing things what we are doing and yet not go on adding the carbon emission. Next. So the essential component of the solution will be reducing energy demand and increasing renewable energy use. The target will be to bring the per capita emission to under 2 ton from where it is today for the PMRDA. It is now nearly 3.58 ton per capita. So that is the kind of decrease that we are looking at, and that is the pathway or the roadmap that we have worked on as to how we can do that. Simultaneously, we must increase the carbon sink by almost 300%. Fortunately, that is the commitment that our Prime Minister has made for the entire country. So we hope that we will all get together and we will achieve that 300%. But even then, there will be a margin. There will be a balance to be compensated. Therefore, the use of carbon capture and storage technology, CCS, or use of artificial carbon removal, ACR, technology, will have to mature fast so that we can lean on them. Coming to the goal, in the document we have listed out many recommendations. I think there are 14 or 15 recommendations. But for discussion, we have zeroed down to 7 goals. Excuse me. The first one, of course, is energy efficiency. It is well known that by just increasing on energy efficiency, you can reduce almost 25 to 30% of the energy demand. Sorry. Second one, of course, is the use of renewable energy to replace the thermal energy to the extent that maybe in 10 years we can replace 70 to 80% of the thermal energy with renewable energy. That can only happen if the renewable energy is available in abundance if it is competitive price and if it is as readily accessible as we are used to. That transition has to happen. Fortunately, the third component we are talking about is direct use of oil and gas and petrol. So the transport sector also has to reduce the emissions. And fortunately, again, there is a government policy to go for e-vehicles. So if the e-vehicles come and if they are really charged with the renewable energy, then it will make a huge difference. Otherwise, it will go on loading the grid, which is still using a good percentage of thermal energy. Next. Next is, of course, that sequestration has to go up. Sorry. And the planned urban development is what is a very crucial thing. Here, the advantage of PMR and PMRDA as an organization is that it is still in the formative stage, early planning stage. It is one of the largest, third largest in India in terms of the urban conglomerate. And therefore, we have a tremendous opportunity to do things right from the beginning. We had a meeting with PMR Chief, Mr. Vikram Kumar, and they are already working on it. We all here, we are hoping to add to their effort and whatever we can so that we can quicken up the pace and do what is required. The goal 6 is about innovation. The innovation and technology can make a major difference because what we have not been able to do in the past, today we are able to do. Simple reason, an example is the renewable energy solar, which today is more competitive than any other source, whereas in earlier, solar was considered to be something which is more expensive. So like that, there are technology transitions happening all over. And of course, as I said, the artificial removal of CO2 will be a critical new technology innovation that has to come in. The last but the most important is the people's momentum, people's movement. When I said the solution has to be local, it is actually down to the every individual. Because carbon footprint is something that every individual has a responsibility. Reducing that footprint as an individual, as a family, as a society, as an institution, as a business, all that starts with an individual. And therefore, awareness of the individual and collectively coming together to create a momentum is the real challenge. I have a next role of technology, just quickly to go through. We have, I think I already mentioned it, e-vehicle will be useful, very good, but it has to be recharged. Hydrogen fuel cell has a huge promise. It is already being used everywhere. It has to be deployed at the level and the scale and the cost. And there are problems, but I think in the 10-year time that we are looking at, the problems will get solved very quickly. Lastly, I'll say, next one, can we go? Next. Yeah. So my last slide is about climate change. We say it is a threat, but I would like to call it an opportunity. In fact, I would like to say that climate change is a blessing in disguise. Because it is happening and things are noticing, everybody is noticing, we are actually today's event itself would not have been possible unless there was an awareness that something is happening. So it's a blessing in disguise. It is an opportunity for the mankind to rise to the occasion, to do what is required. It is the future of the young people. The babies that are born today will be 80 years old towards the end of the century. And if the climate is not friendly, if the climate is hostile, you can imagine what the life would be. So it is upon the present generation to do things right, and the next 10 years, can we go? Next slide. Next. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. No, the last one. So I'm saying the next decade will determine what the next few centuries will do. We are at that kind of a crossroad. It's a crossroad where we have to make a transition in the energy domain. We have to make a transition in the economic domain. And we have to take a transition in the personal habit way of life. So it is this kind of challenge that we are talking about. I would now request my colleagues to discuss a little more detail. So,
Thank you, Professor Malik. Dr. Nitant Mate, Director, Sea Green Solutions LLP, has worked in the field of sustainability in the areas of energy, waste, and water management. May I request Dr. Mate to take over, please?
Thanks, Lisa. So essentially, when we talk about carbon neutrality, the first thing to try and understand is how much are we emitting? And it is very difficult to assess the emissions, but nonetheless, we can go with some basic understanding of science and chemistry, and then beyond that, you can extrapolate or interpolate and then create numbers which will start making sense altogether. But when it comes to emissions, typically what it is essentially any activity has some emission factor. So if you are talking about a chemical reaction, say carbon getting burnt or a fuel burning, then each fuel will have certain amount of carbon dioxide that it is emitting. At the same time, any other activity can be attributed to with some kind of emissions, either directly or not directly. So what I have listed here is a number of entities that can be considered for carbon emission. But I would like to point out the table on the right-hand side that it is not just the carbon dioxide that we should be talking about, but it's the total emissions that we should be talking about, because there are certain gases like methane or nitrous oxides which have more harmful potential as compared to the carbon dioxide alone. So when we are talking about emissions, we should think about the total emissions. When it comes to PMR, we have a number of talukas, and some of them are half in the PMR. But typically, what we see is within the PMR, we have scope 1 emissions, which typically are essentially the burning of fuel in the PMR. So when we are talking about scope 1, it is what you emit in your region. So very simple. Then there is other scope that should be addressed, because we are actually consuming something which is coming from outside, and the measure of that is essentially electricity. In India, electricity produced is about 60% of it, or even more, is on thermal principles. So essentially, coal is getting burnt, and we are typically polluting the environment by producing CO2 while generating electricity, and it is typically in the range of 820 kilograms per megawatt hour of electricity, and that's a lot of pollution. And scope 2 is something that we should be considering, and then scope 3 is something that we typically would tend to forget, but what we are consuming in the region is getting produced somewhere else. It is not about the electricity or the energy. It is something that is being produced outside. And there are major contributors to that, and some of that is actually food and fertilizer. And then, of course, we buy steel and we buy cement, and all that has got some embedded emissions in it, and we should be considering all those emissions as part of our contribution to the total emissions. So if you were to look at a pie, it will typically look like scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. The larger one, that is 42%, is electricity. Who would have imagined that electricity is actually polluting? And on the other side, we are saying that everybody should turn to electric vehicles. So there is something that we need to understand, and we need to act so that even electricity that we produce is less polluting. So what kind of potential do we have to reduce emissions in scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3? I've tried to quantify the things with some numbers, but essentially what it is naturally what we are saying is, instead of burning fuels, try to convert to electricity. So that means typically if I were to look at, say, burning on or cooking on a gas, the efficiency of gas stove is somewhere in the range of 60% to 70%, whereas if I'm doing that with electricity, I can go to 85% or even more. So these kinds of things will make a whole lot of difference, but our habits need to change. But at the same time, we have to be very much aware that I am adding a load on electricity, and that means I have to look at what I can do with electricity as well. And then See, the thing is that if I were to look at electricity, my natural tendency is to go to renewable energy and solar. And then in solar also, we have to think about how we can do, which I will explain a little bit later. And the third thing that we have to understand is the scope 3, which is a lot of times neglected, where whatever food I am buying, it has to be coming from organic farming. If I am doing organic fertilizers, then my scope 3 emissions go down drastically. Chemical fertilizers have very large emission factor. So these are the kinds of steps that one needs to take. And that is where it comes to every individual who has to understand and take steps in that direction. When it comes to solar, one very simple thing is solar thermal, where is using heat or using solar energy to heat water or heat whatever process that you are doing. And it is almost a no-brainer because paybacks are very simple. But if I look at it from a nation's viewpoint, it's even very interesting. See, if I'm looking at, say, 1,000 homes converted to solar water heating systems, then I'm looking at, in the morning, when the 1,000 homes are turning their geysers on, they are putting like 2 kilowatts into the system, between 2 and 3 kilowatts, each one of them. That means about 2 megawatts worth of load gets added in the morning just by 1,000 homes. So if I'm looking at it from the viewpoint of a nation, converting to solar thermal actually is going to reduce my demand on putting larger electricity generation plants. That means if I were to look at 2 megawatts and then think about 2 megawatt installation and the cost of thermal power plant for that, my solar water heating systems are paying for itself on the day they are installed. I mean, that's the kind of psyche that we have to develop into ourselves and understand. It's individual as well as nation. And that is how you have to look at it. When it comes to solar photovoltaic, of course, I mean, in PMR, if you look at the fallow land or barren land that we have, even 10% of that, if you convert to solar photovoltaic electricity, it is going to take care of our present electrical consumption. However, we have to look at future. Because when we say we are developing, that means our energy demand is going to increase and our population also is going to increase. So there are two multipliers with which the demands are going to go high and the emissions are going to go high. So our demand is going to increase on electricity as well because we are going to propagate conversion of fuel to electricity. I mean, rather converting from fuel consuming plants to electricity consuming plants. That means our electrical demand is going to increase furthermore. But even with that, solar alone can be about 50% of the barren land in PMR can give solar electricity enough to compensate for the entire solar that we have. Unfortunately, solar electricity is not available 24/7. And that is the reason why we have to look at other renewables as well, because solar availability, if you look at it, the availability factor is only 19%. Now, if you look at wind, even in PMR, you have got excellent wind sites. So if you look at wind, wind a lot of times complements solar electricity. And that is why hybrids of various systems is what something one has to look at. Now, municipal waste is also, according to me, a source of energy. However, it may not be very large compared to the kind of demand we have. But still, what it is doing in terms of polluting is something that we get rid of, and we also add energy to the bucket. And that is what is very important when it comes to municipal waste. And of course, there are other possibilities, biofuels. If you look at PMR, PMR is part of Pune district. So let me just look at Pune district. If I look at Pune district, it's the grain that is produced in Pune district is somewhere in the range of 4.7 million tons. So that means for every ton of grain, you are getting waste biomass. And that biomass can be converted to biogas, or that can also be converted to fertilizer. So you get organic fertilizer and you also get energy. So these are the kinds of solutions that one has to look at so that we can ultimately reach our goal of carbon neutrality by 2030. Last but not the least, energy efficiency is something that we should look at continuously, because energy efficiency alone, as everybody keeps saying, can reduce your demand by almost 30%. So energy efficiency, See, I have energy available from renewable sources does not mean that I can start utilizing it left, right, and center. I still have to contain my demand of energy, and that can be done only by energy efficiency. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mate. Dr. Priya Darshini Karve is the CEO of Samuchit Envirotech, and she has a PhD in physics and more than 20 years of experience of working as an innovator and entrepreneur in biomass energy and organic waste management. She will talk to us about enhancing carbon sequestration and shifting to a low carbon lifestyle.
Thank you. That's part of what I'm going to talk about. Nitant has talked about the potential that exists in PMR region. And if you look at that, then actually the target of achieving carbon neutrality by 2030 is a moderate target, considering the potential. So I think let's keep that in mind. I'm just going to try and link the potential with the sectorial action points that have been put in the plan that we have put together. When we are talking about net greenhouse gas emissions, that's what we want to drive towards zero, there are three things that we have to focus on. One is reducing total greenhouse gas emissions. Secondly, whatever is left over, that has to be compensated by a couple of things. One is carbon sequestration, removing carbon from the atmosphere. And then there is also a possibility of carbon offset. The strategy when somebody is planning carbon neutrality typically goes like this, that the first step is you reduce your total emissions, maximize carbon sequestration, and then think about balancing, offsetting for the balance. Minimizing emissions with fuels, this is directly linked with the goals 3 and 5 in the plan. We have picked up only some of the actions which are possible, and still we are going to achieve, we are going to move towards carbon neutrality. The steps are pretty logical. The first step is you go in for behavioral changes and systemic changes to reduce the demand itself. Then you look at improving efficiencies. And then whatever is then left over, you try to replace it with renewable fuels. Biofuels is the obvious choice here. But the way we are looking at it, these biofuels also have to be produced within PMR. So it is decentralized biofuels that we are talking about. And that is where all the waste biomass that is available within the region comes into picture. Minimizing total emissions as far as electricity is concerned is linked with goals 1, 2, and 5 in the plan. Again, the same strategy. First, you reduce demand, then look at improving efficiency, and then shifting to renewable energy. And again, here also the focus is on decentralized renewables. Use all the rooftops that are available, use all the wind potential that is available within PMR, and some of the waste to electricity processes, again, within PMR in a distributed manner can be looked at. The indirect emissions is the trickiest part, as Nitant also mentioned, because these are linked with all the various resources which come from outside the region. And some of the key resources, water, may be coming from outside the region. So obviously, we have to optimize utilization of the water that is available within the region, go in for wastewater recycling, and reduce the water input from outside. That is one way of reducing this component of indirect emissions. Agriculture is another part of it, because even if we are talking about localizing of food, realistically, all the food cannot be produced locally. Some of it will come from outside, but we have to optimize the local agricultural systems to the best extent possible and reduce dependence on food chains which are coming from outside. Infrastructure is a very, very critical factor, because infrastructure like buildings, roads, bridges, this gets built only once, but every year it's going to add a component to our emissions for decades. And therefore, looking at urban planning processes within PMR is critically important here. Carbon neutrality has to be at the basis of planning of the development plan of PMR. That is a very, very key process here, and that is linked with goal 5. waste generates a lot of emissions if it is not handled scientifically. So that has to be avoided. Rules already exist for that. So it's a matter of implementing those rules critically. And organic waste can also give us fuels and electricity and help us reduce emissions from fuel and electricity. So there is a dual benefit there. Once you have reduced emission, the next part comes is carbon sequestration. This has to be done using the existing processes that are there, that we have to go for 33% forest cover within PMR, etc. But one has to here take into account that forest cover, increasing forest cover is different from just tree plantation. Increasing forest cover means restoring ecosystems. The local ecosystems have to be robust, have to be healthy. That is a more effective way of sinking carbon. And this includes everything from grasses to trees, and even improving the lake and river systems within the region. All of this will help in improving carbon sequestration. One can increase soil carbon content by using organic waste for direct mulching in the soil, or charring it and then putting it in the soil. These are the simplest technologies that are currently available for removing carbon from the atmosphere. And there are other technologies which will hopefully come up, as Dr. Malik also talked about. All of this will not be possible unless a number of supportive actions also happen, and that is all enclosed in the Goal 7, where citizens, businesses, as well as the government authorities within PMR have to work in collaboration. Everybody has to work towards a single goal, and in order to make that a single goal for everyone, a lot of awareness raising needs to happen, education needs to happen. So a number of actions have been identified for that. In spite of all of this, after doing all of this, we'll be still left with about 5,700 kilotons of emissions. Even those can be compensated. While doing this, we can also try to reduce the indirect emissions, which come from energy, that a little bit of energy that is going to come from outside, the water that is going to come from outside, the food that is going to come from outside. PMR can actually finance in those areas from where we are getting our energy, water and food to try and reduce the emissions there, which will also help reduce our indirect emissions. I should say this, that even if you don't believe in carbon neutrality, we have seen in the last couple of years that Western Maharashtra in general and Pune district in particular is highly vulnerable to climate change impacts. Most of the actions which are included in our plan are necessary for reducing our vulnerability to climate change impacts and improving our adaptive capacity. So even if you are not a believer of carbon neutrality, these actions still have to be taken if we have to survive. It is that dire a situation. So this has the added benefit of reducing our climate vulnerability. And there is an added benefit of economic advantage. It's a myth to say that if we move away from fossil energy, we will suffer economic losses. Actually, staying in the fossil fuel-based economy is going to incur more economic losses. It is necessary for us to get out of this trap in order to stay on the path of economic prosperity. That also will get achieved if we get onto this track. So I believe that by doing this, we can set a model which can be followed by all the cities in the country and all the cities in the world, in fact. We can be a world leader in that sense. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Karve. Dr. Gurudas Nulkar is a professor at the Symbiosis Center for Management and an ecologist. He is a trustee and faculty at the Ecological Society. His research interests lie in exploring alternatives to conventional market economy, environmental sustainability in industry, and issues in agrarian economy.
Thank you so much. I begin my presentation by showing the reason why we are all located here. This is the river which a lot of Punekers have forgotten that it is the Muthai River. But this is the river that once bestowed a unique characteristic and a great personality to the entire city. So I'm going to divide my presentation into six parts. I'll talk about green development priorities, the climate action framework that we have noted down. what needs to be done at the town planning stage, and what constitutes climate equity and justice, and the governance part, which is the reason why we are making a presentation to you. So the green development challenges and priorities, as you can see, you know, my other two colleagues have already spoken about that. I just want to club it into two parts, you know, the land use, industrial and domestic emissions, affordable mobility and waste management is one group of it. The second group is talking about the renewable energy, which is decentralized solar, wind and biogas. And the third group is talking about the new technologies for carbon capture and storage, as well as biochar capture in agriculture. Now, if you group these three, you will see that the first set of challenges are met in scope 1 and scope 2 of carbon capture. The second one is met in the scope 2. And the third one is typically for the third scope, which is the most difficult, as already mentioned by my colleagues. The bonus part, which I would like to suggest after Priyadarshini's bonus, is that we are directly going to be plugging in into the nationally determined commitments, which we have already signed at the Conference of Parties. So I have typically picked four nationally determined commitments, the second, third, fourth, and fifth. The second one is to adopt a climate-friendly and cleaner path, which we are wishing to do with a sustainable land use, and we have some action plans for that. The second is reduce emissions intensity of a GDP. So moving towards green townships, low-carbon economy, and a circular economy, some suggestions are made on that. NDC 4 is about achieving 40% cumulative electric power and non-fossil fuel. So carbon capture, decentralized energy, and waste management. And the last one is to create an additional carbon sink of 2.5 billion tons of CO2 equivalent through additional forest and tree cover, something which is very close to my heart. And that's about enhancing biodiversity, parks, protecting wildlife. So in my next slide, I take NDC 5 as an example and present the chart, which is also there in the policy document. Total area in PMR, total forest area, total trees and groves, all of that adds up to a carbon sequestration potential of a number which is too difficult for me to say here, but it's that many tons of CO2 equivalent per year. How this can be achieved? One is first and foremost protecting the current forested land which we have in Pune, and luckily Pune has a lot of it. Second is implementing the biodiversity parks program on the hills of Pune, which is already being done by PMC. The third is we are lucky to have a lot of wetlands and rivers flowing. We have five rivers, the Dev Nadi, Ram Nadi, Mula, Mutha, and there is a lot of scope for reforestation along that. And the wetlands and the riparian vegetation is something which we need to look at. So wetlands are some of the most ecologically productive ecosystems of the planet, which have a huge carbon sequestration potential. And finally, we are blessed with a lot of government and institutional land, especially defense land, cantonment land. If we can come to some agreement with the defense authorities that we can do reforestation in some part of the area, that will increase to the potential carbon sequestration capacity of the city. The next point which I'm going to make is about the climate action framework that we have proposed, and it comprises of 6 points and 2 enablers. The first one is implementing land use and environmental laws as strictly as possible for the PMR. Second is reducing energy use and increasing its efficiency, which has already been dealt with. Third point is the renewable and the clean energy aspect. Fourth is moving towards a circular economy and waste management. So one of the things which Pune can probably look at is a green economic zone, which will look at a circular economy or a low carbon economy. We have had a couple of SEZs, but we'll probably be the first one to have a GEZ in case we are able to think of something like that. Sustainable transport and non-motorized transport. So Pune has historically been a city of non-motorized transport. When I was a kid, I used to own 5 bicycles, and you know, the entire family used to go on cycle. So, but unfortunately, we have moved out. And carbon neutral buildings is something. Now, all these actions are not possible without two key enablers. First, the left-hand side enabler is multiple stakeholder engagement platforms. So we would want the government to allow this kind of a sharing platform, which will ease that out. And second is from the government side is actions against non-compliance on this plan. So some framework which can be put forth to the citizen, which means they are doing that. Now this entire framework has to look at three verbs. One is mitigation, adaptation, and resilience. We will start with mitigation, but our end goal is resilience. How can we build resilience by 2030? That becomes our most important thing. So some of the things in town planning is a lot of infrastructure in PMR is yet to be built, and therefore we still have time. So planned urban expansion as green townships, land use planning, maintaining a ratio of natural to built environment, especially the hardscapes and the softscapes of land, because we have recently gone through two big floodings, decentralized waste and water management, strict land use norms, pollution control, not just with industries, but also with housing societies, which is sort of lacking at the moment, and ecological restoration, which we are talking about. I'll very quickly wrap up with climate justice and equity imperatives. So what is the cost of a warmer earth? And there are two essential costs which economists talk about. One is the social cost of carbon, and the other is ecological cost of carbon. So among the social costs, these are the ones which are quantifiable in monetary terms. So these are the ones which will eat up your GDP on non-productive use. They will affect human health. But the ecological costs of carbon are the ones which are less easily seen. They are not very visible in the GDP, they don't reflect in the balance sheet, and yet they're doing a lot of damage to society. And some of the damages do not have a technological replacement. For example, hydrological cycle, we have no answer. Pollination, if we kill pollination, there's no way that we can replace that ecosystem service. So when we are talking about the social costs of carbon, we are talking about intergenerational and intragenerational equity. On the other hand, when we're talking about ecological costs of carbon, we are talking about interspecies equity, which is probably not addressed by many carbon neutrality programs.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the two things which I would certainly like to draw your attention to is the political will which we would want, you know, to promoting carbon footprint, facilitating the measurement of carbon footprint, something which is lacking right now. Citizens' pledge, making some sort of recognition or swabhiman to doing the work that we have been doing. Rewarding business performance, I think this is an underrated thing. Shifting carbons and festivals to a low carbon, shifting celebrations and festivals to a low carbon state. And that offers a very high potential to move towards carbon neutrality. Encouraging the shift to high nutrition, low footprint food in the PMR thing. About participative governance, we would like to have a committee which comprises of academia, experts, citizens, NGOs, policymakers, and certainly the bureaucrats who can come on a common platform for the dialogue, and they can measure their progress. Carbon audits in industry and commercial enterprises is something which PMR can look at. Urban agriculture has a huge potential in Pune because a lot of societies have got rooftop farming at the moment, and rainwater harvesting as a culture should be promoted in the PMR region, essentially. Yeah, so with that, I close my... Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nubikar. May I please request Dr. Mashelkar to give us his observation remarks.
I'm just coming in to tell you the flow of rest of our program. The first thing is that we have planned the discussion, roundtable discussion, and we'll start this immediately now. The minister has some time limitations. Up to 4:30, he'll be here, and then he has some other meetings that he has to attend to. So make the best use of the time in terms of our roundtable discussion that we will have. There is just one more point I wanted to...
No, anything.
No, afterwards.
No problem.
After he hears...
I'll interact with everyone.
Interact, yeah, that's it. So we'll do this part very effectively, okay? And Amita, you will be in charge of making sure that it is done effectively.
So, technically I was scheduled to speak as the chief guest before the discussion, but I was requesting Dr. Mashelkar sir to make me a part of the discussion because I've come here to listen to all of you rather than, you know, tell you my thoughts since all of you are obviously working more and in depth in this field. I just want to convey to everyone that the Chief Minister has sent me in particular to listen to all of you, take your points, take your views on how eco-governance should be. And I think we'll start off with the discussion, then I will do the concluding remarks, because I'm keen to hear what you feel about this topic.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that's a great idea. Just shows how much he's interested in the topic that we are talking about. We are very fortunate. So since the time that he can share with us is little limited, may I request a few people who can add value to our discussion, to begin with Mr. Vikram Kumar, who is this CEO of the PMRDA. We've had a discussion, you had taken a look at our document. Would you like to share your thoughts?
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, as PMRDA, we are doing this effect on multiple fronts. Sir, first, PMRDA is just 4 years old, but at this moment, we are in the process of the complete master plan for PMRDA. And when we are doing the master plan, sir, we are taking care that whatever has been presented, because we earlier had a discussion with Dr. Mashalkar and also Dr. Amitabh, and that we are trying to incorporate in the master plan. For example, in Sir Pune, the western part is completely the hill slopes area. The whole water falls in the western parts and flows towards Pune eastern part. Because western part is hill slopes, it's extremely important to protect these hill slopes, because no development should take place on these hill slopes and because they should be protected. So in master plan also, we are accordingly giving due importance to protect these hill slopes, to this hilly region. Also, sir, very interestingly, in Pune, what we are seeing, that a lot of command area, the area which was supposed to be used to grow crops because the canals have been built, etc., is getting converted into residential areas. The command area getting converted into residential areas. So we are trying to protect this command area. We are trying to protect the agriculture zone so that the people, the farmers, should continue to do agriculture in those areas and should not fall prey to real estate gains, etc., etc. Secondly, sir, when we are looking at the implementing part of it, this is the planning part. Now, implementing part of it, sir, interestingly, sir, Pune, if you look at the data, right now in Pune, 10% people use cars for their local commute, 35% use two-wheelers. And when we foresee in future, when the more prosperity comes, this 35% will also shift towards cars. And it will be a havoc on Pune streets. It's extremely important to develop the BRTS, or rapid modes of transport. So accordingly, sir, we have planned, are in process of implementing multiple metros in Pune. In next 3 to 5 years, we can foresee at least 3 to 4 operational lines in Pune, carrying around 5 lakh people, 6 lakh people every day on these metro lines. We are hoping that use of this metro will wean off people from using their private transport. When we see that, so the population of the PMR region, right now PMR region right now is a population around 26 lakhs. And when we extrapolate this to 2041, we see population going to up to 50 lakh people. So population is almost going to double in next 20 years. So accordingly, sir, it's extremely important to have these metros ready by 2041. Accordingly, we have again further ahead connecting all important centers like Chakan, like Hinjewadi, like Wagholi by metros only. In fact, sir, when doing metros, we are planning stations in such a way that stations are within the factory premises only, so that there is no spillover of people from the factory on the roads. The people should stay away from the factory, sit in metro and come to their houses. Because as we are seeing, last mile connectivity is a big problem. People still tend to use their local transport, tend to use their two-wheelers, four-wheelers to go to the metro station. Instead, if we can have metros within the premises of our area, then that spillover of people on the streets becomes less. That's what we are planning while doing these metros. More importantly, a lot of vehicles come to Pune which have no business in Pune. They come to Pune just to bypass through Pune and go to east parts of Maharashtra like Solapur, Kolhapur, etc., etc. It's extremely important they should bypass Pune. Unfortunately, Pune still doesn't have a bypass. Now we are in process of, we have already planned it, in process of acquiring land for the bypass. When this bypass happens, sir, for example, on databases, 50,000 trucks enter Pune every day. Out of 50,000 trucks, only 25,000 trucks are used in Pune. Rest are just bypassing Pune and increasing the CO2 levels of Pune. If we can have a bypass, which we are acquiring land for now, these 25,000 trucks will not harm the PMR region, so as to say, and use lesser distance to travel to western parts of Maharashtra. These are the strategies that we are employing from PMR. And sir, finally, we have just signed an MOU, have started a company where we are developing carbon neutral townships with a Switzerland government backed society. In fact, we also got a presentation and our partner from Switzerland is also here. Probably some other time I can present it to you. These carbon neutral townships are a township in which every person every day will use only 2 units of energy. The idea is that it's only 2 units which can be absorbed by the earth. Rest, it gets added to the carbon footprint. So these townships we are planning to do this year in Pune. The work will start this year in Pune. And in next 5 years, the township should be complete in all respects, sir. Whenever, sir, next time you give us an opportunity, we will present this carbon neutral townships to you in detail, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, so Pune has been forefront in the rooftop, in accepting the rooftop solar. But we have seen many issues which have recently cropped up with regards to levying charges, grid support charges, which will defeat the entire purpose of implementing rooftop solar. So we would require the support from the state government to ensure that the policies related to solar RTPV are made more amicable for housing societies. And just to add one more point related to groundwater, which is the part of the NGO which I belong to. We have seen that the groundwater extraction in the Pune region has increased, and a recent survey and report which we have published stated about 4 TMC of groundwater we are extracting every year, which is very, very high. We are already taking 13 TMC from the dams, and we are extracting 4 TMC from groundwater. And this will, groundwater resources will deplete to an extent where they cannot be replenished later. So there are 2 or 3 immediate actionables from the state government. There is a groundwater survey development agency, department of the state government, where many vacancies are not being fulfilled. So we don't have geologists to take care about the hydrogeological survey. We had insisted on having a groundwater department in every urban center, in municipal corporations, municipal councils, as well as panchayat samiti levels. And that was taken up. It's now also part of the Jal Shakti policy. So that is needs to be expedited. And the GSDA Act rules have not yet been notified. So since 2009 and 2019-20 now, the rules have not been notified. So extraction of groundwater happens rampantly without any control. If you request support from the government on that.
So the only thing in the rooftop policy I would require from you, and especially because I've been trying to pursue on this issue for the last 2-3 years, is 2-3 things if you could give me in terms of a paper which I could submit to the government. One is with the rooftop policy, what we've done in Mumbai is we've made solid waste management a priority. Right. And in that, of course, looking at it as a priority, whoever has pits for composting, we've given them property tax rebates up to 5%. And we're also doing that for the rooftop solar. In that, we've also given them an exemption from FSI rules if you make a composting pit. So if there is something like that, where we could specify incentives that we could make for rooftop policy or rooftop solar panels, if there is a way to store this in a better way, because normally what happens is you can use that energy during the day, then to convert it at night, the hot plate is obviously running, so that charges are coming on the discount. So that is another place I would need your research and help on, because I think these two issues, if we can put them on the right track, then we can move ahead. And the third is, if you could give me a study to obviously convince my cabinet colleagues on the environment and the economic impact of having rooftop solar panels that could have, you know, that could be positive for Maharashtra. So if you could give me that.
Yeah, definitely. It's already done. He's part of our
customer. Okay, fantastic.
Sarangma, Yadavatka Sahib, to Porakai, about your.
I would like to mention. In 2009, central government directed all state governments to prepare a report on climate change, how they are going to face climate change. Maharashtra government allotted that work to TERI. TERI started the work in 2010 and submitted a very comprehensive report in 2014, which is hardly visible. And I request you to go through that. And particularly as far as Pune region is concerned, in that report they have divided Maharashtra into 6 divisions. As far as Pune division is concerned, they have stated that in next few decades, the annual rainfall is going to increase by 37.5% with reduction of wet days, resulting in more occurrences of cloudbursts. On that background, if we look at the city, Pune, as you said, there are 5 rivers: Mula, Mutha, Pauna, Indrayani, Ramnadi, Devnadi. And there are 7 dams upstream side, immediate upstream side. And the city has a saucer-shaped topography. So we are actually a very, very flood-prone city. We need to take into consideration. That is one thing. Now, as far as development is concerned, the development model that has been followed for last many decades, as I think, is completely urban-centric development model. In Pune, there is metro is around 30,000 crores. Riverfront development, so-called riverfront development, which is canalization of river, channelization of river, killing the river, that is going to cost us around 4,000 crore rupees. Ahmedabad model, typical. Yeah, that's another debatable issue which I would like to discuss in details with you. Yeah, thank you. Cheers. Yeah. And so because of that, see, there the total development cost of development around Pune is around 4 lakh crore rupees, including Hyperloop, which is now going beyond the horizon now. So I think if we distribute that, shift that amount, shift that budget more towards rural area, the migration towards the city will reduce. Actually, the question is of differentiating between obesity and health, growth and malignant growth. We are having malignant growth these days, and we need to stop that growth and revert back to health. There are ways to do that. And I request you that there are many individuals and NGOs working for last many decades on various issues like air pollution, rivers, flooding, and traffic, and all that. Unfortunately, it's a complaint, you can take it as a complaint, no problem. We are never taken into confidence while preparing these projects. And that is a very big issue. We don't want any money from that. We are ready to work without any earning for that. And please take our opinions and study into account while preparing the projects. Thank you.
I think I will go back to PMRDA, the Pune Metropolitan Region Development Authority. If you look at the regional plan that has been prepared and published, it's available, I just checked it, it's available on the website. The plan is totally oriented towards construction. You know, there are 138 villages in the PMR region, and no thought has been given to what is going to happen to the villages. You will have realized that all of us actually are on the same page as far as this is concerned. And if you look at the plan that the PMRDA has prepared, it is just looking at the lands from these villages as the new land market where they can just give phenomenal amounts of FSI and create, you know, they think they can create a lot of money. But actually this market is going to collapse because there will be no takers for it. Apart from the carbon neutrality or carbon emissions or whatever, I think it's an economically unwise, unsound decision. You know, because this is not the way things are going to continue. So one needs to take, I think, a re-look at the regional plan and take really what Sarang was saying, take people like us who are working for this for so many decades, and we are competent people, we are professionals. I think it needs to be taken on board before these plans are prepared. The other point that I would like to make is that when we talk about carbon neutrality, carbon sinks is a very simple way of doing things. We worked very hard to save the hills in Pune. For really 14, 15 years I've been working on it. And we have saved the hills in the sense that the legislation is in place. But government itself is not ready to implement that legislation. You know, somebody was asking me, is the area demarcated? Yes, there are absolutely beautifully demarcated maps which are available. And it's not a very difficult deal. You know that no construction should be allowed there. That is the law. So if you can help us with, you know, things that are already in place and looking at the plans that are prepared and make them environmentally more sound. I mean, as town planners, we have very simple ways of doing these. We always say that look at the land use ratio. You know, it's very, very easy. So in itself, if you use 60-40 is the ratio that we normally talk about. What is 40%? It is for protection of all the natural environment. The built environment has to be contained in 60% of the land. So more land is being given to built environment. Out of that 60%, the construction footprint should not exceed 30% of that 60%. You know, 50% of that 60%. That's what it is. The remaining area you can use for circulation, roads, because we need roads, you know, amenity spaces, all these kinds of whatever we require in the town to have a good quality of life, that is what is given by the 60-40 ratio. 40% is enough for your 33% forest, for your 4-5% water bodies, all these things are taken care of. But we are encroaching on these vulnerable lands through planning. The town planning department, the government, state, your municipal governments, they are ready to encroach on these lands because there are no protectors and these are very cheap lands. People think these are cheap lands. These are very important lands for us, you know, for our protection. So if you can help us in that, that would be great.
Thank you.
Just a small interjection here, sir. What ma'am said is about the 1997 regional plan. So we are preparing a fresh plan now that was prepared in 1997, 20 years back. So that's why, because there are so many mistakes in that plan, we are preparing a new plan.
Yeah. I would just like to add here that in all our discussion in making this document, what transpired, what came very clear is that if only we were to follow the rules and regulations that are already there and somehow manage to enforce strict compliance, so much could change. But unfortunately, our system being what it is, there are problems, and that is something that we have to overcome. We have taken a very tall challenge, so therefore everybody must come on board. I will, if there is any comment. Please.
I would like to touch only the housing for poor issue in a minute. 35% of the Pune people stay in slums, and the way the rural poverty is shifting to the Pune city, it is bound to increase almost 50% in coming 5 years. Now, government has some plans like PMAY, SRA, both are non-starters. SRA, frankly, nothing much is coming. PMAY is also, nothing much is happening. So, sir, my humble request is that to accept the informality as a solution to the housing for poor, and add PMAY support, very small support, because PMAY gives support of 2.5 lakhs of rupees per house for a formal house. I would like the informal house to be given a subsidy of about 25,000 rupees, and the lives of almost 35-40% of people will be better. That's all.
Thank you. Any other quick question? Go ahead, one more.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Shivam Trivedi from Praj Industries Limited, and I'm also a research scholar in the field of biodiversity and landscape conservation. Now, I would like to add 2 points. One, the city of Pune. The city is a human being, where the governance body is the brain and heart of the city, and the lungs are the green spaces in the city, which needs to be conserved, and it needs to be conserved urgently. And not with exotic species, which are water-hungry species, but with indigenous species, which can attract forest birds. And as Gurudas sir said, that it can also increase the pollination within the city. My second point is the fringe area of Pune, which is now expanding towards the Western Ghats, which is a global biodiversity hotspot. There are several biodiversity-rich islands within these Western Ghats, which needs to be conserved, because they are in the form of sacred groves, forts, plateaus, and they are potential refuge site for several wild species. And if in the flow of developing the city, if these islands are cleared, then there'll be incidences of wild species entering into the city areas, which are again a harmful impact to the societies. So yes, while taking these hot specs, I call it hot specs, the green biodiversity islands, they are the hot specs which need to be conserved. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm Dr. Anupam Saraf. I just want to point out something about why we are here. I think we are basically in a climate emergency because of the business models that we have been practicing for decades. And I think if we have to succeed in ensuring that we take some action towards getting climate neutrality, from the government perspective, I think there are two things which are important. One is that every government bureaucrat needs to know that the government is committed to this goal. So although in 2015 the Prime Minister signed the Paris Accord, till today the government has not issued a single notification indicating to the bureaucrats that we are committed to increasing our carbon absorption capacity by 3 billion tons. It has still not indicated that we are committed to decreasing our carbon emissions by 30%. So I think one first step, if you could take, which is to notify to the Maharashtra government that this is a commitment which was made by the Prime Minister in 2015 and has not been implemented across the country, but each government office has to take into consideration and report back what they are doing about this commitment. Without this, it's not going to happen. Second is that we need to be able to measure exactly what we want to accomplish. And therefore, it's important that every government office is asked to report what is the carbon emission and carbon sequestration of every project that they take up before you sanction their budget. Because without that, it's just not going to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. I think given the time, may I request the Honorable Minister to share his thoughts and we benefit from that.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for inviting me here. Thank you, Dr. Mashirkar, for having me over for this important conference. And I'm so glad I made it here because yesterday I was actually, I caught a stomach bug, I had fever, neck ache, sinus. I was feeling like Mother Earth and just wanted to see. But this morning when I woke up, of course, I remembered, and like Dr. Mashirkar rightly said, you know, on the 1st of Jan, the first day of the new decade, the Chief Minister, who also happens to be my father, had invited Dr. Mashirkar over for tea. And I was in another cabin and, you know, I just walked past saying, you know, I was leaving for another meeting and he made me sit down to interact with him. And over the years, of course, I mean, I've seen my father and the Chief Minister have very, very high regards for Dr. Mashirkar, for his work, for his contribution. And I remember how excited he was when you inaugurated the virtual classrooms of Mumbai Municipal Corporation. So it's always when, you know, he has a certain say that the Chief Minister is always keen to implement things. And I remember from that discussion that he also mentioned that the PIC would play a very important role in government policies from now on. So I think that is why I'm precisely here. It's also that we realize that this government is very, very keen on the environment impact reports that are submitted for each and every project. Because in the last 5 years, most of the protests that have been a part of most policy decisions that have opposed have always been on the fact that we are ignoring the environmental impact of a particular policy or a particular project. Where that comes from is a long history, but to cut that short, I remember in 2003 or 2004, when I was 15, when I was the age of Greta, I had watched a movie with my school called The Day After Tomorrow. And I don't know how many of you all watched it, but The Day After Tomorrow, that movie hadn't let me sleep for two, three nights. And after two, 3 nights, I slept very fine, thinking, okay, this is the day after tomorrow. This is not happening today. This is not happening tomorrow. This is, you know, long time after I die. This is at least 7, 8 generations after us. This is the next, this is in the year 3000. And in the last 10, 15 years, I started realizing that the day after tomorrow is actually now. So the sound effects whenever, you know, that were in the movie when they showed a glacier retreat, or when they showed something in Antarctica fall down, or the rising water levels. And when you read that in the newspapers, you start thinking, oh, this is not the day after tomorrow, this is today. And this comes out of a selfish interest for my generation, for myself, where if I have to survive the next 50, 100 years in a very happy, peaceful, healthy way, it cannot be in a situation which is a climate emergency. You know, as politicians, we always promise, and I keep saying this everywhere, as politicians, we always promise Wi-Fi hotspots in different elections. I hope the time doesn't come on to us to promise oxygen hotspots from the next election onwards.
Very good.
And
very good.
That is why I'm here. And, you know, let me congratulate you for, this is the first conference, Mr. Malik, this is the first conference, Professor, that I've come to, and I've actually heard electric mobility be supported by renewable energy. And this is what I've been saying constantly, because electric mobility was, you know, something of a fascination I had when I was the age of 23, 24. When I first went to London, I saw electric buses. And I saw electric buses, I said, wow, they're emission-free, they're noise-free, let's bring them to Mumbai. Back then in 2013, before FAME 1 and FAME 2, the BMC actually earmarked a fund, and we brought in 6 electric buses to Mumbai by 2015. This year, we've got 40 already in our fleet. The next year, we're going for 300 electric buses, fully electric, not even hybrid, fully electric. But whilst we do that, and I started interacting with more and more companies who are into electric mobility, interacted with 5-6 of them, speaking about swappable batteries, speaking with charging stations, how can we increase the amount of charging stations in a city, I also realized we need to create an ecosystem of electric mobility that is actually clean. Because till now, we've been burning coal, we've been burning, you know, fossil fuel on one end of the spectrum, and we're actually saying this is clean energy, which is really not. So we need to bring in electric mobility with an ecosystem that is actually clean. One of the small projects that I'm initiating, and I've already spoken to MSRDC, they're in charge of Mumbai-Nagpur Highway and Mumbai-Pune Expressway. Two things we're trying to initiate out there. Mumbai-Pune is, someone rightfully mentioned, is the catchment area for rainfall. And a lot of the rainfall just flows down into the valley, untapped. We have good ducts, we have good pipeline systems that take the water down into the valley. I have requested them to start a feasibility report whether we could actually tap that rainfall, rainwater, channelize it into a reservoir for government of Maharashtra. Wherever we have a drought, we can move that water into those regions. So that is one of the first things I've requested. Then the other thing is, a lot of these regions are open spaces on both the sides. And the median is about 8 to 16 feet long, wide. If we can have solar panels placed in these highways, Mumbai-Nagpur and Mumbai-Pune, I think that could be another catchment area. I just saw this report in the morning, and the vertical wind farms, I would be more than happy to have them placed on our highways. Of course, the Western Express Highway in Mumbai, you wouldn't generate that much because the speed is around 10 to 15 kilometers per hour, unfortunately. But on places like, you know, in Mumbai-Pune or Mumbai-Nagpur, Mumbai-Pune especially, where overspeeding is a habit now, till we control that, I think the wind would be very well generated. So that. However, recently I was in Delhi for this conference called Resina Dialogues. And this whole conference was on air pollution. A part of that roundtable conference was on air pollution, and I was a part of that panel. One of the key persons who was speaking out there was Prime Minister Shering Togbay, the former Prime Minister of Bhutan, who was very, very key to linking poverty alleviation to carbon neutrality to tourism. And thankfully, the two ministries that I asked for and I got are tourism and environment. And both these ministries till now have been side ministries. They've not really been the key ministries. They've not been the Ministry of Home Affairs. They've not been the Ministry of Education or Higher and Technical Education, which are seen as key ministries. But I asked for them precisely because I believe these are the ministries of the future.
Sure.
These are ministries that have a great potential, and these ministries need to be key. Again, environment ministry as such has been, I was just speaking to Dr. Mashirka, that environment ministry has been a very regulatory ministry. It's to do with common effluent treatment plants. It's to do with recommending STPs. It's to do with putting FIRs on municipal commissioners when they don't put STPs. And setting great goals, saying, okay, this is our BOD, this is 30, bring it to 10, NGT said 10, you know, and things like that. And one of the reasons I took this ministry is because when I say it's a ministry of the future starts from today. You can't be 30 years old, which I will be this year, till you are born. And you have to be born on a particular day. You have to start off and you have to live every single day when you reach 30 or 50 or 70 or 100. Each day is groundwork for the next day. And I believe when we say the future is coming, the future has to start from today. And that is why I took this ministry. Again, one of the key reasons and the oath that we have given to the students in schools, I want to make this ministry more participatory, proactive than reactive, and more people-based than policy-based. Because if we have people awareness, public participation, that is where we can really make a change in the environment. I'll give you two, three examples where I strongly believe that public participation can help. Of course, Pune is a great center for public participation because when I worked on the ban on single-use disposable plastic, Pune, Parla and Shivaji Park, these three areas have, you know, gone into greater depths of imposing this ban rather than anyone else, and they actually made it into a movement. Movement is very important, and if we look at any sort of pollution, be it air pollution, be it water pollution, be it even visual pollution, it is all interlinked. We cannot treat them in different silos. We have to see the interconnectivity or the ecosystem that comes out from. Like I mentioned in Delhi at the Raisina dialogues, I said air pollution cannot be only looked at through the perspective of stubble burning or vehicular movement. We also have to involve government models into this. We have to involve public participation into this because something like solid waste management, so many of our incineration plants still do not have treatment capacity to make those the smoke that is coming out of it or incineration that is happening from there or the solid waste that is burnt in different municipal regions into eco-friendly mechanisms. We still don't have that. If that solid waste management or solid waste is rather not managed, it goes to dumping grounds, which rather I don't believe that should be in our city anymore. The dumping grounds, if they're not managed properly, they create leachate, water pollution, runoffs. All of these things are interlinked. One of the first examples I would like to give you about where my hope stems from and why I believe that this carbon neutrality of 2030 is an achievable goal, even though it's just 10 years away, is the example of the city of Mumbai. In the year 2017, our solid waste collection daily, anyone has an idea of how much it was? 10,000 metric tons a day, unsegregated. 10,000, you were very close. But from the government, you have an idea, so that is 10,000 metric tons of unsegregated waste every single day. The High Court came down strictly on us in very harsh words. They told us that, you know, right now it's 10,000 metric tons a day. In the next 3 to 4 years, you will hit 14,000 metric tons a day, and then you will be going higher and higher. Do you have any solutions for this? And obviously our lawyer said, no, we don't have. We'll come back to you, Lordship. In the meantime, our chief secretary, Mr. Ajoy Mehta, who was back then the municipal commissioner, he sat with the chief minister who wasn't the chief minister back then, and we devised a plan where we said we have to do something on this. The first target was bulk generators, anyone who's producing beyond 100 kgs of waste every single day. We said we won't pick up your waste, you can do whatever you want to, but we won't pick up your waste unless and until you segregate it. Then we identified housing societies, we identified establishments, we went to restaurant associations, we went to hotel associations, we went to malls, we went to hospitals, we went to every type of waste producer, and we said, look, we want to reduce our waste consumption, we want to reduce our waste generation. If you can segregate your waste every single day, we will obviously collect it in different means and mechanisms, so can you start off with segregation? They said, fair enough, but tell us how to do that. We started awareness programs, we started having exhibitions of composting units. There were three things we did. One is segregation compulsorily. Two, we in the DP 2034, we've given an exemption to composting pits made in different housing societies from FSI. And three, ward-wise, we have 24 municipal wards in Mumbai. We started having exhibitions of the best technology neutral exhibitions. We have 70 or 80 companies come and display our technology. The ALMs, housing societies, NGOs can buy it, participate in it, and move forward. By 2020, when I speak to you today, can you take an estimate of what is our waste collection today? 6,500 metric tons a day. So we've actually come down by 4,000 metric tons only by segregation and no other, you know, rocket science. It's just been segregation. Now, the best part is with all the scientists involved here, if we can achieve something more in terms of technology-driven methods or mechanisms to use our waste better, to generate electricity out of it. One of the biggest problems we face in Mumbai, of course, Pune has a couple of examples of waste to energy, but in Mumbai, we've not been able to generate it because of a calorific value. But if there is any mechanism you can put pitch for the entire state, of course, I was very happy to read about Pune neutrality, but I was a little disappointed of not including the entire state into this. We need to look at the state as a whole, and when we look at the planet, and we look at the Paris Accord, when we look at the Kyoto Protocols, when we look at any other, you know, great intent, I believe that India can be a leader because we have a population of 1.3 billion people. Think of the amount of impact, positive or negative, that India can have on the other 6 billion people. We add 1 billion to that 6 billion, we create 7 billion out of it. India as a whole, with the amount of economic activity, with the amount of private activity, with the amount of just people breathing in our country, we can have. I think that is a key thing. But when we talk about urbanization and rural life, and when we talk about urban planning, I strongly believe that planning is necessary now, and government planning with private planning, with eco-planning is a necessity. We're looking at trends in the government when we're studying trends across Maharashtra where urbanization is increasing day by day. The first time in the history of probably our governance, we are not really scared of urbanization. But urbanization obviously entails a couple of things. One is better healthcare facilities, better education facilities, better solid waste management, better management of our water resources, better management of what we emit or give out as waste to the nature. So I think these are things we need to look at rather than only concretization that comes along with urbanization. Looking at the larger perspective of, say, rural areas or urban areas, the government has right now announced a big loan waiver for the farmers across Maharashtra. And the loan waiver has been a necessity this year. But to avoid it year after year, we need to look at two things. One is agriculture as a whole. And when we speak about agriculture, what is the climate change that is happening today? Because see, again, like I said, climate change isn't now only restricted to the glaciers in the Himalayas or the poles. Climate change is happening in each and every gully of our city, each and every aspect, each and every taluka of our state. And when I speak of climate change, I've seen it with my own eyes, because the last 4 years, political program for us has been go into drought-hit regions and help people. Last 1 year has been wherever there is heavy rainfall or unseasonal rainfall, go and help the people. So this has been the political program. But if you have to move forward from this, I am trying to bring all politicians on board where we have to say, let's adapt to climate change. We can't adopt climate change, but we have to adapt to climate change. We have to build systems that are resilient to climate change. I have seen in villages where people have, of course, not had a single drop of water for 4 years and have had floods in the next year. And that is what is scary today. Like someone rightfully mentioned, the amount of rainfall days has reduced and the amount of rain has increased. In Mumbai itself, right from 120 days, it's gone down to about 72 days. But the amount of rainfall has increased. For example, Mumbai, I can tell you a small example. I speak of Mumbai very often because in the last 10 years, I've worked deeply inside Mumbai civic system. The issue of Mumbai, after the 2005 cloudburst that we had a brimstone project. We've put in stormwater drains. We've increased the size from 25 mm to 50 mm as per international design standard. We've put in pumping stations. Each of the pumping station has a pump. Each pump can throw out 6,000 liters of water per second. So if you've noticed Mumbai, it's reduced from flooding, which used to be for 2 or 3 days, to waterlogging, to about knee level for about half an hour, 45 minutes. And still we cannot throw out water for those half an hour, 45 minutes. The only reason being the increase in the amount of rainfall and the decrease in the rainfall days. For example, 29 June. So for the whole month of June, we did not have rainfall. But on 29 June, we had 485 mm of rain in a single day, in a span of 4 hours. And that is the fear of urban planners now, that is the fear of government, where we are looking at systems or climatic systems or situations which are catastrophic for us. Look at the amount of storms and cyclones and forest fires in the newspapers. Each day, the events are increasing. And that is where this conference holds great importance to me. Some of the systems that you've discussed out here, of course, we speak about carbon sinks. And let me tell you, as Environment Minister, when I was interacting with all the municipal commissioners across Maharashtra, I've set 3 or 4 basic targets for them. Of course, all of them are through urban perspective and a couple of them through rural perspectives also. But some of the key aspects that I've set for them are, A, we need to have urban town planning in each and every thing that we do now. So, of course, traffic management is one of the key important things that we need to look at. When you speak of traffic management, dispersal of traffic is very, very important, because we cannot say that the traffic can be reduced. We cannot say that the amount of cars that anyone holds or buys today can be restricted. We are not a restrictive economy. But when we speak about traffic management, we need to look at traffic parking areas. We need to look at clearing our streets from parking. We need to look at how the commute can be easier from one place to another by either private vehicle or a public transport. When you speak about public transport, we need to bring in metros. Of course, that is one of the most important things. But again, electric mobility in terms of public transport, which is electric, be it something like BST buses. One small example I'd like to give here is of reducing the rates and making it more affordable to people. The BST buses that we brought into Mumbai, of course, everyone knows BST has been, you know, it's legendary for Mumbai. We have a current fleet of 3,000 buses. We run on 7,000 routes. We are actually increasing our fleet from 3,000 buses to 6,000 buses. We are bringing into operations mini-sized buses, medium-sized buses, and larger fleets, the legendary double-deckers also. But whilst we do that, we're looking at last-mile connectivity, and we are actually converting this whole transport system from the from one place to another to a last-mile feeder service. So when the metro comes in, we have Mumbai Railways network, we have metro, we'll have last-mile connectivity through electric buses of the BST. We reduced our fares, so now the fare slab is 5 rupees for 5 kilometers, 10 rupees for 10 kilometers, 15 rupees for 15 kilometers, and 20 rupees for any amount of distance beyond 15 kilometers. The direct impact this has had is within a month, we've had 10 lakh more people using our BST. And now the necessity is to use 3,000 more buses. This is what we're looking at when we look at urban town planning. The other thing I've told them is to have solid waste management. Like I said, segregation is a necessity today. But the third thing I'm looking at is urban forests. And urban forests in the sense of having local species of flora fauna that are disappearing, and especially trees that are disappearing from these cities to be brought back into our city. So a city like Mumbai, we just initiated on 26 January, our Republic Day, where we've taken 65 plots of the BMC that were being not used very efficiently. We've converted them to urban forests. We're using the Miyawaki plantation method, but we're using native species. We're adding 400,000 trees to a city like Mumbai. So I think these are key areas. And again, urban forests and urban farming, both areas I'm very keen on, because the people of the future, the kids, need to go out, school kids need to go out and not do beach cleaning. They don't need to go into movements of the government which are cleaning the streets. We shouldn't have a Swachh Bharat movement existing after 5 years, because all of these things are penalties. We're imposing penalties on the kids to go out, clean our beaches, clean our streets, clean our parks, clean our public playgrounds, because we as a generation have spoiled it for them. And now we're making them clean it. I think it is on us today as government to include efficient energy usage, to include renewable energy, to include better solid waste management, to include better water management. One of the things in water management is also rainwater percolation, because our runoffs are almost 85% in a city. So as Environment Minister, I've mandated the municipal corporations, now we'll have a GR on that, to have rainwater percolation, not just harvesting, but percolation, so that our groundwater increases in every municipal corporation as well as every rural Zilla Parishad. But we need to look at policy framework and implementation of the framework where we're not penalizing our citizens by movements, but actually making it a lifestyle habit that we keep our planet cleaner. And I think India is again a global leader in this, because we just need to be a little more religious and spiritual about the environment. Where we started off as a civilization is we were nature worshippers. We worshipped forms of energy. We worshipped air, we worshipped water, we worshipped fire, we worshipped the sun god, we worshipped, you know, the Pancha Mahabhuta. The moment we made them into idols and brought them into our temples, we started polluting our gods and the source of energy, and we started worshipping idols. I think if we just can go back to our source of energy and start worshipping them again, that's where we make them pollution free. So on that note, I think, you know, I'd like to conclude, not take a lot of time, but I've made a lot of notes out here with my brilliant handwriting, which I cannot read. But it's almost like a doctor's handwriting. So let's make this a habit, actually, because, you know, in terms of one meeting is not really enough. What I would really like to do and take forward from this conference is smaller, finer, quick wins. I've seen the plan for 2020, 2025, and 2030. I believe we cannot extend till 2030 because we don't have that much of a time if we have to look at climate emergency. When I started off with any movement in the environment department, you know, I've seen so many countries put out great targets, but it's on paper and it's at, you know, two decades away. We need to start today. So what I would like to initiate from here is if we can set a date of every 2 monthly review and a discussion that we can have together. If we can have, like, for example, PMRD is only 4 years old.
Very good.
We have a greater scope there. We have MMRDA, which is already running. We have municipal corporations, we have Zilla Parishads, and you have an environment minister who's 29 years old and is hoping to live longer. So if we can have reviews every month, if we can have at least a meeting where, if not on anything else, on video conference, if on email, if you could initiate an email chain, and there were certain issues that we can achieve through sustainable development, because there will be two ways to this. One is, of course, a complete eco-friendly way. The other is a complete infrastructure way, and there is also mid-path, which is sustainable development. I think if we can achieve that, wherever we can have a healthy dialogue, if we can have more think tanks coming in, if we can have more thought processes coming in, urban planning, rural planning coming in, I think let's have a monthly or bi-monthly review on this. And with the presentations, if you can give me quick wins, medium-time goals, and 2030 goals, let's start implementing them. And let's make a policy framework and an SPV for the government of Maharashtra. Let me speak to the CM, let me discuss this with him, because what I have proposed is that the environment department have, you know, it should have a key role in every other department of government. I think that is very important today. So on that note, thank you, Dr. Mashirkar, for having me over today. And it's an honor, and I hope that I have been able to contribute at least a little to this conference, and I hope that I can take back a lot from this conference. And in the next 5 years, as my term of environment minister, I can look forward to your cooperation and advice. One thing I would like to tell you is, of course, being 29 years old, you can keep protocol aside and advise me openly and without any fear or favor on this. Thank you. Dhanyavaad. Jai Hind. Jai Maharashtra.
Thank you. You know, people call me a dangerous optimist. I've become even more dangerously optimistic about our future. I think that our future is in safe hands. Let us give him a big hand. Amazing, amazing speech, full of knowledge, insight, but most importantly, wisdom. Can't believe you are 29. Right? So I'm absolutely delighted. Couple of quick points before we break. One, this is about, of course, Pune. But you know, we had this Progressive Maharashtra as a policy paper laying out the roadmap for the next 5 years. Pune is a thought leader, of course. Pune International Center is a think tank. And lots of technologies which will be looking to the West are getting generated right in Pune. We didn't make a reference to that. As we speak, for example, Praj, 8% of the bioethanol in the world is produced based on their technology. Their presence is there in 75 countries, by the way, footprint in 75 countries. There is this KPIT technology. They have created technologies where fuel cells, which we have to depend upon the others, there is a complete indigenous development, much lower in cost, much higher in performance, 3 kW already proven, 6 kW being tested within 3 to 4 months. That will be done. We have our own strengths now in fuel cell. Now, fuel cell will require hydrogen. And there again, we have to use our imagination. For example, one of the things I mentioned to the Honorable CM on that day is that how can you solve so many problems together? For example, there is a technology that has been developed where biomass, which is locally collected, can be generated into fuel cell quality hydrogen. I mean, can be converted. Now, you can just imagine, it will solve the problem in many different ways, including increasing the income of the farmers, looking at the environmental issue, taking care of local economics, dealing with climate change, and being a feed to the and this is generated in the city of Pune, I'm very proud to say. So public transport, for example, and by the way, the calculations show that the costs are as good as the current diesel. We want to sort of do it better. Technology is there, it has to be supported by policy. And with you there, I'm quite sure that will happen. In fact, our dream would be that under your leadership, you know, Maharashtra can become the first carbon neutral state in India. It is possible. I mean, it gives me that particular confidence. I'd like to end this by saying that we'll have now a cup of tea where we will have a chance to meet our Honorable Minister, have a little chat, a 15-minute break. And please do continue the discussion, because everything that you say is being taken note of, and we'll make a full report, and particularly in the format. I love this, you know, low-hanging fruits first, so that we can show quick results and other things, and we'll be actually submitting to you. So whatever you say is extremely precious, so do continue with this. And let me do a pleasant duty. First, there are two books, you know, and they are Kelkar and Mashelkar. I don't know whether you are aware, there is a saying in government, or used to be, that when in difficulty, form either a Kelkar committee or Mashelkar committee. So between two of us, we have had something like 30 plus committees, you know, including National Auto Fuel Policy and all sorts of committees. GST, as you know, is the father of GST and so on and so forth. So this book, Leapfrogging to Pole Vaulting, I had presented it to your father.
Yes.
When you came, I know you took it away.
Yes.
Right. Now this is your copy.
Thank you.
And then there is another very profound book which we launched recently, Vijay Kelkar and Ajay Sa. This is in service of Republic, but it is about the art and science of policy making. So it's with great pleasure that on behalf of all of you, I present these books to all of you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.